Welcome to the Evening Creek Building, and thank you for those of you who are online as well. I am so pleased today to be able to introduce somebody that I think can help us transform an educational experience for our learners. You may see her on Dr. Phil sometime. You might find her on CNN. You might find that she's won an award for serving her community, for changing the lives of people for generations. And all of that is good and wonderful. But today, what I think is most important for us is we have somebody who has walked in the steps, stood in the shoes of many of our learners. She can speak firsthand about the power of education, how it transformed her life, the life of her family for generations. She can speak firsthand about some of the challenges to taking advantage of educational opportunities. No, she doesn't speak for every single one of our learners, but she speaks to many of our learners. And I think learners that some of us could learn more about. So I'm very excited and very pleased, and I hope that you are too. And I hope that you'll ask questions. This is the first step for one that will take us much further down a path to get us closer and closer and closer to seeing the world through the eyes of our learners. Dr. Donna Beegle.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you. So, and welcome to those of you who are online. I am honored to be here. And do bring that perspective of having been born into generations of folks who can't read and write, folks who make an X for their names. Many of my family members, that's how they sign their signatures, with an X. Now, and being reflective, how many of you think you have students and families in your communities or who you're serving who have family members who they themselves may struggle with literacy? Or maybe they can read a little bit, but they couldn't read a newspaper. That's the kind of world I come from. So the first time I read a newspaper, I was 28 years old. And all through school, I didn't know the words that my teachers would use. They would talk about things, and I would say, what does that word mean? And my teachers would say, you need to be a responsible, independent learner. Go look it up in the dictionary. I will not enable you. So I would go to the dictionary and find four or five more words that I didn't know. Four or five more words that not a single human being in my environment knew. There was nobody to ask. It was as if the people who were making it had this secret code to making it, and they wouldn't share it. They would send me to read textbooks or were other words that I didn't know. Because raise your hand if you agree with me. We are segregated in America. And I'm talking by social class. So if you just reflect on who do middle-class people hang out with, we're not sitting down to dinner with folks who are using those middle-class vocabulary. We're just not. It's there's nobody in your environment. And it wasn't only the vocabulary I didn't know. It was the examples that were being used to explain subject matter. So think about where humans get their examples. When you explain something, where do you get your examples? From your own lived experience. So if you grow up in a more middle-class environment and you're teaching a subject, what examples are you using to explain that subject? Very highly likely they are from middle-class experiences. So you hear a lot of, well, everybody knows this, everybody's done that, and a lot of taking for granted assumptions about the exposure that people have or have not had. And so the examples weren't relevant to my life. And learning theory, my doctorate is educational leadership, and learning theory says human beings can't learn unless you can make your examples relevant to some experiences that they've had. This is like that. In fact, part of the way I was able to make it through community college, because I got my GED when I was 26 and entered the world of community college where I found a whole lot more words that I'd never heard before. I found a subject matter that I had never been introduced to. I remember one of my instructors was talking about Watergate, and I said, "What is that Watergate thing?" And he said, "How could you not know this? Aren't you American?" And I was like, "Oh, I don't know. I don't know why. I don't know what everybody else just seems to know." And I took beginning classes, and I was the only beginner in there because other students had had that exposure from their family, from the womb, or they'd had that exposure from high school. I didn't have high school. And my family were migrant labor workers, so we were highly mobile. I was born in West Phoenix, Arizona, and my family would go through California for cherries and then into Oregon for beans, moss, pine cones, bark, and then into Washington State. I actually had my honeymoon in a cherry field in Washington State at 15. So I do have that perspective of what does it look and feel like to enter an educational system when you don't grow up in a context where people are using those words. And a lot of the folks who, I don't know if you'd be surprised if I told you this, majority of the people who talk about poverty, teach on poverty, the majority of people who do research on poverty, would you be surprised if I told you they haven't lived it? So the experiences are basically people looking in at people who live in the crisis of poverty and then describing their behavior through what middle-class people would do. So our students and families in the crisis of poverty come up short every time, or in the deficit approach. What's wrong with them? Why don't they adjust? How come they don't? There's no real clear understanding of what their perspectives are. So if you look at our present situation, we have right now in our schools in America, half of our children are qualifying for free and reduced lunch. Half. And many schools, I do a lot of in-services around this country. I've worked in all 50 states now. And I work with education early learning. I work with K-12. I work with higher ed. I work with the legal system, the health system, the social service system, the faith-based communities, the business communities, elected officials, because all of these sectors impact the lives of students and families who live in crisis. So this work, to me, is much more than work. I tell people I know too much to be quiet. And how many of you know what happens to a student who doesn't make it in our education system? Can you guess?
More likely to end up in prison.
Exactly. We have more people in cages than any country in the entire world. And that is both youth and adult. How many people have been in prison? I mean visiting. So if you've ever been, and I encourage people to go just as an educational awareness piece, you will hear poverty, 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 poverty. 80% of the people who are in those cages, they can't read at eighth grade level. Half have untreated mental health issues. And we're learning more and more. Majority have undiagnosed learning challenges like dyslexia, Asperger's, that were not caught in our K-12 system. So we lose them in our education system, private or public. And it's almost a direct pipeline. Raise your hand if you think we can do better. Raise your hand if you think we better do better. You know, we have right now scholars projecting that if we continue on our current rate of incarceration in the United States, it won't be long until half of all Americans have jobs that in some way are related to caging the other half. Right now it's 1 in 32. So the work that you do as leaders, as educators, could not be more critical in a labor market that demands education or a skill. So you have statistics like 11% of students from poverty complete their college degrees, if they're lucky enough to make it into a post-secondary learning opportunity. That's our just really unacceptable results. And if they're foster care, it goes down to 3% success. Well, why is that? Where's the community? Where's the supports? There's this assumption that something's going to happen out there. I remember all through school, my teachers would write things on my papers. They'd go, fragment, run on. I never knew what those words meant. I knew they were bad because they were red ink, right? But I was 28 years old, when a professor finally sat down with me and said, let me show you what a fragment is. Because the assumption was I would get it out there. And when I didn't know vocabulary, and people sent me to the dictionary and I'd find five more words, they would say, I'm not going to enable you. When I was getting my doctorate in educational leadership, I kept thinking about comments like that, and I was like, wait a minute, why wouldn't you enable me? That was your job. But the word enable in our country has become an excuse for not helping. Maslow taught you cannot enable a human being who doesn't have their fundamental human needs met, because they can't self-actualize without support. So if an action isn't going to occur without additional supports, it's not enabling. And Maslow never said, hey, go do everything for people. But he sure did say do it with them. If there are words they don't know, walk them through it. The only way you can learn the meaning of a word is if somebody who knows that word dialogues with you and puts it into context and relates it to something that you already know. A recent research study just came out where they said students from poverty enter our schools with a much more limited vocabulary. And I'm like, yes, I know that firsthand. And then the study said, well, what we're going to do to try to address this gap is we're going to send middle-class people out to talk to parents and teach them how to talk more to their children. Now, I read that study, and I was like, how insulting. We're talking to our kids. We just ain't using middle-class words. But the assumption is you're not talking. See, the deficit. We got to fix the people, not let's fix their exposure. I was recently training the largest health corporation in Minnesota. It's a private health corporation, because they're serving more and more people who live in crisis of poverty and wanting to really improve communication and relationships. So the director came up to me at the very end, and he said, Dr. Beegle, he said, we just contracted with the organization, and for $200,000, they are going to convert all of our medical forms into fourth grade reading level. He said, do you think that will be helpful? And I said, well, it depends. Are you talking about fourth grade reading level in a high poverty community or fourth grade reading level in a privileged community? His vocabulary will be totally different. So will the examples. Who knows that? I mean, all you have to do is think about this. You can go to any country, any community in the United States, go to any community, rural or urban, and just ask this question to a real estate agent. Ask this question. Where are your good schools? Which means we all know what? None of our kids get the same. So why do we treat them as if they do? We have this fundamental belief system in the United States that everyone starts the same. How many people in this room and online got that memo? Everyone has the same chance. There are opportunities out there if you really want it. Who got that memo? I did. But see, your world is shaped by the people you interact with. And the isolation of poverty ensures who you're hanging out with. I'm hanging out with other people who are salt and butter. So in my view, I thought that everybody was born to parents who can't read and write. I thought everyone got evicted. I thought everyone went hungry. I was 26 years old, and I was in a pilot welfare-to-work program. And these four women stood up and told their life stories, middle-class women. And they stood up and told their life stories. It was my first time ever hearing the stories of middle-class people. The segregation ensures and also perpetuates the poverty. So they told their life stories, and I'm 26, and I'm sitting there going, you went to one school? seen get evicted. You've never been hungry. You had a doctor? A dentist? Car insurance? Credit? I had no idea. My mind was just spinning. And I'm thinking, well, no wonder you get to be on that side of the table. My whole life, 26 years, I believed the reason people made it was because they were better than us. I thought everybody started out migrant labor workers, and somehow through their morals and their intelligence and their ethics, they got out. But we just couldn't figure it out. I thought, at one point in my life, I thought, maybe we have the bad genes. It must be that you come to believe there's something wrong with you, because our society teaches everyone has the same chance. When in fact, some people are born to educated parents. Some people are born into stability with a pillow to lay their head on. Others, like me, are born fighting their five brothers for the back window of the car, because that is the best place to sleep. You know, you get to see the stars, and there are no feet in your face. So it became to me really clear when I heard these lived experiences that, well, you're not better than me. Maybe I could do what you did, which is become educated. It took me realizing that the reason people make it isn't because they're superhuman. Because you come to believe that because everybody seems to know the words. You go into the classroom and you have students who already know the words. You go in. When I went to Mount Hood Community College, I was in beginning photography. The other students already knew the terminology when they came into the classroom because they'd heard it from parents or they'd heard it from high school. So you just kind of get smaller. Like, I don't know why I don't know. I guess I'm not smart enough to know. It's called internalized personal deficiency. And Paulo Freire, who wrote Pedagogy of the Oppressed and many other amazing books on educating students in poverty, his book, Pedagogy of the Oppressed, should be a must read for anyone who wants to make a difference. But he talks about, in the United States, you're the only country in the world who teaches your people they are the cause of poverty. In other, you know, you go to developing nations, you don't hear people saying things like, you just work harder in this third world country, you wouldn't be poor. You make some better choices in this third world country, you wouldn't be. They're actually honest about real, true structural causes of poverty, like affordable housing, living wage jobs, access to excellent schools for all of our children, nutrition. All of the things that help us to be the best humans that we can be, that the assumption is that it's built in. So here I've put up some guiding questions for us to reflect on in our time together. What does poverty teach? And how does it impact educational opportunities? How does it shape the students who sign up for your courses? Is the worldview when you come into an education system where you're from generational poverty or working class poverty or an immigrant poverty experience? Or maybe a situational poverty experience? And we're going to define those different life experiences of poverty so that we have a shared definition. What have you personally, as a leader, as an educator, been taught about poverty? Where does your knowledge base come from? I grew up believing that the people who were making it didn't care. Has anyone in here ever heard a student say that? No one cares about people like that. If you ever have a conversation with somebody, particularly generational working class poverty, you're going to hear that. No one cares about people like us. And I grew up believing that. And some of that comes from, you know, the lived experiences of poverty. Like, I was a seventh grader, and I told a teacher, I don't want to go outside. They fight out there. And she said, there's nothing I can do. I have work to do. You need to go out. So I went out, and I was beat up. And my hair fell out by the handfuls. No one cares. I used to watch my mom and dad. They would go into a helping organization to ask for help, plastic or glass between them and the people. And my mom, I'm the tallest woman ever in the history of my family. I'm 5'1". She was never tall enough to speak into the hole that was cut out of the plastic or glass. So the helping professionals would often scream at her for not talking through the hole. And I remember as a kid thinking, do you have bad parents? Like, why don't you talk to them face to face? Why don't you find out our family, our names, or what's going on with our family? But that wasn't my experience, because we have such a fragmented approach to addressing the complexities of poverty. So I came to believe that nobody cared. And I believed that up until I was 28. I was convinced that people didn't care. And some of it comes from what's on the walls. The studies show where if you go into communities where there's high poverty, you could go a couple of blocks away from the organizations and you'll start seeing no, don't, stop kinds of messages. Whereas you go into privileged communities, privileged education systems, welcome, dare to dream, be all you can be kinds of messages on the walls. You go into a welfare office, you choose welfare, you choose work. I train welfare workers, I say, I can think of 1,000 ways to say that nice and uplifting. You don't have to beat people down, they're already down. How about you just found some wonderful resources to help your family earn a living? We tend to take that, the research shows a more controlling approach, control them and discipline them, whereas in privileged communities, it's more about challenging and questioning. The student in poverty who challenges and questions is labeled deviant and sent to the office. The privileged student who challenges and questions told they have leadership skills. The same behaviors are defined differently according to social class, so your messages that you get are different. So I did believe that people didn't care, and I made it to University of Portland. I'm going to talk a little bit about how that journey happened, but I made it to University of Portland, which is sister to Notre Dame. And I began seeing people doing caring behavior. I mean, they were volunteering at battered women's shelters. They were donating their time. And I was like, well, that's incongruent with what I've grown up believing. It looks like they care. So I began thinking, well, if they care, why aren't they doing something? Why would you allow this to happen in your own community? And I started having conversations with people about poverty. And two things became clear really quickly. One, they cared. And that was a huge part of my growth. Mother Teresa says to believe your fellow human beings don't care is it's more painful than hunger. I agree with her. The second thing I learned, at the same time I learned that they cared, I learned that they didn't have a clue. They could no more know my life in the war zone of generational poverty than I could know middle class norms, middle class vocabulary, middle class expectations, middle class exposure to possibilities. They didn't have a clue. So much so that there are a lot of assumptions made about poverty and the people who lived in it. So I started listening to people's definitions of poverty, and I was like, oh my gosh. One guy, he said, I grew up poor. All you got to do is have the right mindset. You got to want it. And I said, well, how did your family get by? He said, well, my father was a physician. He died when I was 12, and I had to go live with my grandparents, and I worked in their store. And I pulled myself up, and I became a doctor like my dad. And I'm listening to him through the context of generations of poverty, and I'm thinking to myself, you knew someone who owned a store? And you're related to them? That's not poverty. But if you look at it from his worldview, his context, who do the children of professionals spend their time with? Other children of professionals, right? So you compare yourself as a human. What we do is we compare ourselves to the people around us. So if you grow up with the people around you having more, highly likely you internalize you grew up poor. I started thinking everyone in America grew up poor. Everyone I talked to, yep, we grew up poor. We didn't have anything but a farm. You own land? Another guy said, well, I grew up with nothing. I made it. You just got to be determined. Successful attorney now. And I said, wow, what did your family eat? He said, oh, my dad owned a restaurant. But anyone could do that. You can't just own a restaurant. Few things have to happen there, right? Like some knowledge, credit, skills. But that's the other faulty assumption we make I did it, it was easy, therefore you ought to be able to. Because we project our own lived experiences onto other people. So imagine the guy whose father died when he was 12, which is situational poverty. So, and painful. But different from generational, different from working class, different from immigrant. Imagine that he would come into contact with somebody from generational poverty. How do you think he would treat him? Probably a lot like this. Hey, I did it. Why can't? Because he's not considering, what would having a father who's a physician for even just 12 years do for your vocabulary? Your sentence structure. I said ain't every other word. I didn't know when to say gone or went. When, how those people know when to say seen or saw. I didn't even know I wasn't speaking middle class sentence structure, but I knew my whole life people couldn't hear me. Because don't we equate IQ with the way people talk? Not with, that's how every single human being they have any meaningful interaction with talks. I was 28 years old when I got to the University of Portland and so very privileged to have Dr. Bob Fulford as a professor. He had studied language and social class his entire career. And he said to me, I want to help you learn a second language. And I'm like, what? He said, Donna, when middle class people speak, they use a very specific sentence structure. They use vocabulary that they have heard in dialogue in context since they were in the womb. They talk about topics that are in their everyday environment. You can't know any of that if you're not exposed to it. He said, you communicate beautifully and it works for you. Let me give you the language that will help you in education and the workplace. So I am now bilingual. I speak fluent middle-class language. And what he taught me was, be careful, because if you get tired, your grammar can revert to your native language. It is a sentence structure. It is a language. But he never, ever said, you talk wrong. That's the deficit model. He said, you communicate beautifully, and it works for you. Let me help you over here with the words you're going to need over here, with the sentence structure you're going to need over here. Because, see, our students who live in the crisis of poverty, every moment they're awake, they're getting pelted with what's wrong with you. Why don't you have this car? Why don't you live in that neighborhood? Why aren't you making this kind of money? Why aren't you wearing these kind of clothes? Why aren't you doing this? Why can't you? So they're constantly pelted with that. So they internalize. They internalize and they lose self-confidence and steals their hope. So what's the point of trying if I'm not smart enough? A lot of times instructors or professors will say, well, I give them assignments, they don't even try. I'm like, I know why. So I want to help you with that piece. But it starts really critically with examining your own attitudes. So what does that word mean, poverty, to you? Together. And just ask you, it doesn't have to be Webster's perfect, but I'm just going to ask you to share some of the images that came up for you and what was your brief definition in the short time you had to come up with that. Someone start us off. They're bringing a microphone, so.
So we said it's the access to available resources determines like a level of poverty because there are different levels depending on what you have at your availability.
Access varies by social class. And that's a foundational understanding we have to have in order to really truly open our doors and meet our students where they are. Not where we want them to be, but where they actually are. Someone else share. What are some of the images?
The image that our team visualized first was homelessness.
So let's just talk about that for a second. Raise your hand if you know right now, today, in America, we have a housing crisis. So how many of you are listening to our elected officials? And how many of our elected officials are talking about a housing crisis. Every single year for the last 15 years, HUD has done a housing affordability study that reaches all parts of our country. And every single year they report there's nowhere, nowhere that a person on disability, a person on subsistence welfare, a person earning minimum wage can afford even a modest apartment. Not one town in America. That's why you see so many students who are doubled up, tripled up, living in cars, living in campers, attending classes from storage sheds. Because that the storage shed epidemic has been our latest for the last 5 years, is people can get the storage sheds for a couple hundred dollars a month, so they're living in the storage sheds. And they're taking classes from there. They're taking classes from their car. They're taking classes. Had one student who told me that she lived in her car and she would go to the hospital and pretend she was visiting someone so they would let her wash up. We have students in these contexts. Are we ready for them? Not are they ready for us. But we have a housing crisis. And housing is a fundamental human need. To have a place to lay your head, to have the luxury to focus on learning. And in a labor market that demands education or skill. So are we ready? Do we have the community partnerships we need to really support our students in connecting to a place to lay their head? We're going to talk more about that. Someone else share. Go ahead with yours.
It was homeless, and we were talking about the holistic nature of the experience, not that we've ever lived in that place per se, but we imagine not just being cold or dirty, and we're talking layers of dirt that go into the skin, feeling alone, feeling exposed. At the same time, somebody might be hungry or thirsty or need medical care. Something's aching from sleeping on the sidewalk all that time. But then the overwhelming feeling of hopelessness and fear, because the longer it continues, the less likely it seems like that something will change. So the hopelessness, the shame, and the fear were the pervasive feelings that came with our image.
Poverty steals hope. And then just to turn this a little bit to our own perceptions about poverty and the students and families who live in it. I taught at Portland State University, and one of the classes I taught was how language shapes our actions. So I put up on the board, the homeless. And I asked grad and undergrad students, what comes to your mind when you see these words? And people said, dirty, lazy, drug addicts, drunks, every stereotype you could imagine. So I put up the mentally ill. And I said, what comes to your mind? And they said, crazy, insane, heroin shooters. So then I went to a different board and I put up people without homes. Tell me what comes to your mind. And they said, oh, lost their job, had a fire, got sick. And I put up people who are mentally or physically challenged. And they said, born that way, had an accident, got sick. Do you see the difference? One is internal blame, one is external. There are real causes. There are real reasons for people being in these situations. All I did was put the people back in. And that's what I learned at the University of Portland. The majority of people get their information on poverty from a lived experience, which is then projected onto, well, everybody's poverty looks like this. Or somebody they knew who had an experience. But the number one teacher of poverty in America is the media. Raise your hand if you agree with me just a little bit. The media dramatize. The media sensationalize. The media are going to give you the worst case, extreme cases. So what is the average person going to know about poverty? They're going to know the stereotypes. And they're going to know the myths. We graduate people from college to be psychiatrists, probation officers, elected officials, business owners, instructors, without ever having Poverty 101. I've literally asked thousands. This is my 26th year of doing this work. I've worked in all 50 states. I've asked thousands of judges, doctors, lawyers, professors, faith-based community members. How many of you have had the course, History of Poverty, United States of America? Never see a hand. We don't know our history. And what is that saying? If you don't know your history, you are doomed to repeat it. Our history shapes our current actions toward people who live in the crisis of poverty. So in the 1700s, they made it illegal to be poor. In the Pennsylvania area, they passed legislation saying that if you can't feed your family, when you leave your home, you have to wear a pea on your sleeve. It has to be red or blue, and it has to be 4 inches, because they wrote, if we can just embarrass people, they will quit acting poor. Raise your hand if you can think of current policies, rules, practices that are founded on that thinking. If we can make it hard enough on them, if we can make it tough enough on them, they will quit acting poor. Herbert Gons, in his book, War on the Poor, he says, we keep asking people in crisis to act middle class. And when they don't, we hammer them. I know professors who will lock the door if a student is late or not accept assignment. How many of you are on time when you're in crisis? Can we all agree that poverty is crisis? And is it just one bullet of poverty hitting our families, our students? It's multiple. The car got towed, the clutch went out, somebody got arrested, there's no food, the lights got shut off, the water got shut off. It's multiple crises hitting our families. We are the only country in the world that teaches our people they are the cause of poverty. And they come to believe it. They lose hope. They lose confidence. And if they get fortunate enough to be guided into an education program, there's got to be support built there to help rebuild that confidence. So I'm going to give you some tools for doing that. But let's hear from other folks real quickly. What images, what definitions came up for you as you were thinking about that word poverty?
We didn't make it to write in a definition, but what was really interesting at our table is that we looked at images from very, very rural settings to very, very urban settings, but all three of us had images of buses and the notion of the way public transportation intersects with the experience of poverty. So I felt like that was interesting.
So let's talk about transportation. How many of you believe that we have transportation systems that can get our students and families where they need to be when they need to be there? You know, what we do to our fellow human beings who live in crisis is we say, don't drive unless you have car insurance. When you're in poverty, you got to drive even more, because you got to comply with the fragmented human services. So I would go into an organization, I'd say, can I get some help turning my water back on? And they'd say, well, we'll help you with $25. You go find some other organizations to help you with the rest. Once you get that, come back to us, and then we'll give you another $25 check. So I train human service professionals. I'm like, why are we asking people in crisis, driving illegally with wires sticking out of their tires, to coordinate our human services? They don't have the capacity. But this goes back to that whole idea of the worthy poor, the unworthy poor, this historical stuff. I've studied the history of poverty, how we came to our current beliefs about poverty and the people who live in it. Rarely do you hear a conversation about affordable housing, living wage jobs, excellent childcare for all of our folks. And that's another whole area. How many people in this room or online have heard of somebody, or you yourself know people who are living a middle class life but are leaving their jobs because of the cost of childcare, which they're now saying is equal to a cost of 1 year of tuition at a college? So our middle class folks can't afford childcare. I have a friend who runs an emergency room, and she has two boys, two little boys. She said, Donna, I'm quitting. She said, I make $200 after I pay for the boys' child care. She's not worth it. And she's privileged. She can quit. What about our families who are attending classes online, who are living in working class generation? What are they doing? How are the children in our communities? That's why we have latchkey kids. We have kids being pulled out of school to take care of the younger ones. And rather than have a community-wide dialogue about what are we doing to make sure that all of our children have excellent childcare, because that's their foundation, we tend to say it's your problem. Where's the community in this? The community is often operating in the ignorance about poverty, and so it turns into blame and judgment. So what's the first thing you think of when you see somebody with rotten teeth? Number one answer in our country, they didn't take care of them. They're drug addicts. Why aren't we saying, wow, 43 million people can't go get preventative care? I wonder, you know, it's twice that for dental. I wonder if they've ever had a dentist. Or how about, I wonder if they've ever had nutrition to build strong, healthy teeth, because we know it requires nutrition. My brother Wayne, his whole mouth is full of super glue, because he accidentally discovered while opening a tube of super glue that it deadened the pain. I broke a tooth not too long ago and he handed me a tube of super glue. I'm like, I am not using that. I was doing an in-service and a janitor came up to me. I was sharing this and he said, yeah, Dr. Beegle, you know, your brother said he can make his teeth stop hurting with super glue. How does he do that? Because I got this. Majority of the people facing poverty are working. Census tells us 2/3 of the people who are fighting poverty in our country are working. And they're not just working one job. They're working more than one job and they can't afford rent. We don't talk about true structural causes of poverty. And so our systems then get set up in ways that serve you if you live in a middle class context. If you don't, then you don't fit. So how do we create systems where our students who live in generational working class immigrant poverty experiences, situational poverty experiences, fit into our higher education institutions? That's what we have to do, because we live in a labor market that demands that. So what are the realities and facts that all educators need to know to really begin to work on some of the misconceptions and assumptions and projections of why don't they just? What do we need to know to do that? We want to talk about that. And what can we do to really create the kind of relationships? Who in this room and online has seen literature saying that if you want to educate students in poverty, you got to have a relationship? Got to have a relationship. Can you build a relationship online? Of course you can. Of course you can. How do you do that? How do you do that? So you have a lot of literature saying you need to develop a relationship. What I teach is if that relationship isn't based on identification, it's not going to work. When I tell people at 15, I never knew a soul who used education to earn a living. At 15, I never had met a person who benefited from education. Most folks will say, but wait, you knew your teachers. My master's is communication. And communication theory says to be in a conversation with someone is not to know them. To be in a room with someone is not to know them. To have an online exchange with someone is not to know them. To know someone, you must identify with them. And this is scholar Kenneth Burke's work. You want to read more about identification theory, pick up Grammar of Motives. That's the book. He wrote books cross-discipline, brilliant genius. If you like really dense academic reading, go get Kenneth Burke's books. If you like it translated into more user-friendly, get mine, See Poverty, because I translated it. It's the kind of book where I would read it and go, huh? Read it again, huh? Read it again, huh? But one of my mentors, that was his guy, so I had to read him, and I'm grateful for that now. But identification requires self-disclosure. who in here has worked in an organization or heard of policies like this? Don't get personal with the students. Don't share personal examples. Don't tell personal stories. So imagine that the only person that I have contact with who has benefited from education or uses education to earn a living is doing this. I teach the opposite. I need your stories. I need to know, how did you get to be who you are? How'd that happen? So let's talk about three levels of self-disclosure. Level one, sharing information. This is where most helping professionals stay. I teach writing. I tell you about writing practices, and you go offline or you leave me. What do you know about me? I'm a role, right? I'm an instructor or I'm a professor. I'm a social role. Level two of self-disclosure is when you teach your subject matter and you share something that builds common ground with your students. You share something they wouldn't know about you that helps them see you're just a person. You may have had different experiences. You may have had different exposures, but we're way more alike than we are different. So level two self-disclosure is sharing your information, but also building that common ground, taking the time to help your students see that they're not so different from you and you're not so different from them. You have way more in common, regardless of race, social class, gender. We're way more alike than we are different. So, and it's so easy to find common ground with our fellow human beings because we are way more alike. Level three of self-disclosure, that's what I think a lot of these policies are about. Because level three of self-disclosure is when you tell me all your problems and the conversation becomes about you. Or you pull all your skeletons out of the closet, your deep, dark secret. Kenneth Burke says you don't have to go to level three, but you do have to go to level two. So what I just asked you to do was level two of self-disclosure, sharing something about yourself. Here's some things that happen immediately when you go to level two of self-disclosure. Your facial features relax. You don't even have to think about this communication strategy because it's built into, we're wired this way. How many of you noticed when you started to share something, your facial features got more welcoming, more inviting? Anybody ever hear students talk about instructors are cold and unfeeling? It's usually because they're staying at level one of self-disclosure, so they're not showing facial expressions. Because that comes with level two. And students from poverty, if they see you, they're looking at your face to see, do you like me? Do you like me? Do you like me? Do you like me? That's first. Do you want me here? I was training several thousand teachers for a Title I event, and the speaker before me, she was talking, and she said, I know some of you don't like working with these students in poverty, but you need to find a way to smile for them every single day. They deserve a smile. You find a way to put a smile on your face. If you have to, you fake it. And I saw people kind of going, oh, yeah, they deserve a smile. And I was like, you know, I'd like to give you more information about the students so that you actually like them. Because how many of you know they're going to see right through you? You can't pretend to want me in your course. You can't pretend to like me. That's a gift all human beings have. We can see. Who here has been in a conversation with somebody, you're talking to them, and within seconds you realize, they don't like me. Did they have to tell you? No, because that's a gift of human communication. We know it. You don't want me in your course? I can feel it even online. You can't pretend. You don't like me? You don't think I'm a learner? You don't think I'm smart? I know that too. You think I have a drug problem? I know that too. We can feel it. And if you're judging, you can't connect. If you can't connect, you can't communicate. If you can't communicate, how on earth will you educate? And how do humans suspend judgment? Gotta get more informed. We gotta gain poverty competencies. We gotta understand how to separate the students from the poverty so that we're actually fighting the poverty, not the students and families who live in it. So Level two self-disclosure, sharing something about yourself, can really change the entire interaction. If you go to level two, you don't have to go to level three. But if you help your students see that you're just a person, share your story. Tell them how you came to be who you are. You can build common ground just by telling somebody how you feel. Feeling overwhelmed today. Because all humans have the same feelings. In spite of what the media teaches, media have so dehumanized people in poverty, we don't even believe they're the same species. So I was on a plane. This woman saw my book, which is a great, how many of you agree poverty is a sensitive subject? Bring stuff up for everyone, right? Everybody's got an opinion. So this woman saw my book and she goes, oh, those people. They have no love in their lives. They never have any fun. And I said, you know, I was born into poverty and we had a lot of love. And we had a lot of fun. We just ain't got no money. That's what the media have done. They have dehumanized people. We don't even see them as the same species. There's some subculture over there, not like me. We are more alike. Have you seen that picture floating around the internet? It's a row of skeletons, full body skeletons, and there's like 10 of them. And underneath it'll say atheist, gay, white, black, but they're all skeleton. We're the same human species. We all have the same emotions. So you share your feelings and you build common ground. It's that simple. I've had people say, I don't have time to build common ground. I have too many students. Look at our data. You don't have time not to. Because that is what turns the corner. When students identify with someone who uses education to earn a living, it becomes somewhat possible. Maybe I could. Because the perception is the people who are educated, they are way too much better than you. There's no way you could ever do that. No way. When I was finishing my bachelor's degree, I had people say, you could get a master's. And I was like, no. And I was talking to my counselor, and he's like, Donna, you could get a master's. You want a master's? You could get it. Oh, I'm not smart enough for that. He said, Donna, you're at the University of Portland. You have a 3.91 GPA. How could that be if you weren't smart? And I said, my professors like me. And he said, well, they're not going to jeopardize their professional careers for you. And from my background, I'm like, well, why not? Because I'm thinking, if somebody needs me to say something, I say it. But it wasn't enough to just hear it. What it took was me being around people who had master's degrees, having conversations with them. And I'd be talking to somebody, and I'd be like, so what did you study? Oh, I have a master's, and they would name some subject. And I'd talk to them for a little bit, and I'd be like, you have a master's. Alrighty then, I can get a master's. Because what I was realizing was they were just people. They weren't better than me. They had different experiences, different exposure, but they were just people. And that is the core definition of role model, is somebody I can be like. I can't be like you if you're better, smarter. I can't. And the truth is, you know some things, I know some things. And we're not stupid. But the media have taught people in poverty are ignorant. They don't know anything. We know a lot. We know a whole lot. Three of my brothers, I have five brothers. I'm the only family member who's not been incarcerated. It took three of my brothers to Washington, D.C. They had never been on a plane. And we get on the plane, and the flight attendant said, there are two exits on this plane. You're going to want to know where they are because it's your only way off this plane. And my brother Wayne, who spent most of his life in a cage, said, the hell it is. And I'm like, I'm going to go sit by Wayne because he'll find us a third door. I have no doubt. Because if we have a natural disaster, who are you going to go spend time with? I'm going with the people who know how to make something out of nothing. Incredible, incredible skills and resourcefulness and creativity. Unbelievable. And you can tap that right into education. But you got to shift your paradigm to a place where you see what's right about our students and come from poverty. Raise your hand if you know if you look for problems, you'll find them. Who in here has had a car that you got rid of and you got a different car that was new to you? Close your eyes. What color was it, your new car to you? What color was it? What make was it? What model was it? Picture it. Now open your eyes. Before you got that car that was new to you, how many of those did you see on the road? After you got that car that was new to you, how many did you see? They were everywhere, weren't they? Where were they before? They were there. But human perception is so powerful, it will make you miss things that are right in front of you. If you're looking for what's wrong with people, what they don't know, that's all you see. You'll never see what they can know. What people know when you get them isn't all they can know. That's just what they've been exposed to. How many people in this room and online have taken the graduate record exams? I never felt so dumb in my life. This word is to this word is, that one is to that one. I'd be like, okay, I know one of them. So it was a 4-hour test. By the time I got to the first break, I'm sobbing. Who did I think I was? I can't go to graduate school. I'm not smart enough. All the tapes, because it takes a long time to undo those messages. You're not smart enough. You're not good enough. Something's wrong with you. Something's wrong with your brother. Something's wrong with your entire family. You guys got the wrong genes kind of messages. So I called my mentor, Dr. Bob Fulford, at the break, and I was crying so hard I was hiccuping. And he couldn't understand me. He finally said, Donna, spell it. So I said, L-E-V-Y, what is it? I said, oh, come on, Donna, you know this. Drove my Chevy to the levee. I don't song, but what is it? I was born in Phoenix. I might know that now because of Katrina, right? But just because I don't know what a levee is doesn't mean I can't know what a levee is. You know, folks who believe that IQ is fixed, folks who believe that learning is fixed, they don't do well with students from poverty. Nor do they do well with students with special needs because they're so focused on what they don't know, what they can't do, rather than looking at, wow, look what they did do, and now how do I build in the pieces that they need to soar in the education world? How do I build that in? I want to share with you a preview of a documentary. This documentary is a PBS documentary. It's being produced by an executive producer named George Rivera out of New York City, and George has 5 Emmys on his mantle in New York, and I think you'll see why when you watch this brief preview. This is my Uncle David. He's my mom's younger brother. And Larry, he's my oldest brother. And then Melvin and Rick. This is Wayne. This is Steve. And my mom, Ruth. My grandma was a cotton picker. She survived picking cotton. She worked in a laundromat doing the wringer washers, lost her fingers. My mom was born into a cotton picking family.
My mom and I would go out and pick cotton and we'd make $30 a day picking cotton. It was enough as long as we had her check coming in from my dad's Social Security and a little bit of welfare.
She's amazing. I mean, she's managed to get 6 kids through some extreme crisis, trauma, hunger, homelessness, and here we all are.
All 6 of my kids, they are the most important thing in the world to me. All 6 of them learned how to clean house, how to do the dishes, whatever needed to mop the floor, whatever needed to be done, all 6 of them know how to do it.
And when we did have a place to live, it was always in the ghetto. It was always in this neighborhood where there were no sidewalks and the roads were, if there were roads, you know, the bumpy kind of thing where people won't bring their cars down who have nice cars. And where you're not really safe walking around. You're going to get beat up or, you know, something's going to happen. All that becomes normal. I remember as a kid, it was just absolutely a normal thing to have somebody come and shut off our lights or our water. You know, we go turn the water on. They've been here. No water. And you improvise and you make do. One of the things we don't talk about in this country is garbage service is an absolute luxury. If you're making choices between rent and food, where's garbage service on the priority list? You know, we say, well, just because you're poor, you don't have to have garbage piled up. Where are you going to put it? My family would take it down to an apartment complex dumpster and try to put it in, get caught, get fined, and then my mom's Dunkin' Donut check or money my dad made, you know, driving the ice cream truck, would go to pay the fines. And if you have garbage, you have rats. It wasn't very long ago at all. I remember a rat this big ran across my chest in the middle of the night, hit the wall, bounced down. Normal. We survive mostly by picking fruit. My mom worked in the potatoes. She worked in the onions. If we were in Arizona, it was grapefruits and oranges. My mom cut grapes. My dad cut grapes. My dad unloaded watermelon trucks. He drove ice cream truck. We all worked in the fields. And we lived in berry cabins. We lived in cars. We lived in the woods. We lived behind truck stops because my mom always said the truckers would make sure we were safe. I don't know what I am. Am I Dutch or am I Swedish or what am I? I don't know. You know, there's no records. You know, I don't have childhood photos. I don't know what did I look like as a little girl growing up. I don't know. I'll never know because in poverty, things get taken away from you. You learn not to care about anything because caring is just painful. So you let it go. Your people become who you have. And even if they're not doing things you're proud of or you really want them to be doing, they're yours. They're yours. So I can say anything about my five brothers. You better not, because they're mine. Steve is 44. He's got a lot of common sense, huge heart. He is considered to be mentally retarded by the state. Lives on $550 a month disability check, and he tries to supplement his income by going into Washington State and collecting bottles out of the dumpsters and then going back to Oregon and cashing them in for the deposit.
I've been arrested for bottles. I've been almost kicked out of the state of Washington over bottles. You know, and I told him, hey, this is not a bottle to me. This is a 5-cent bounty. As long as it says Oregon bottles, they give you a nickel back.
My uncle David is my mom's younger brother. He's also disabled, can't read and write. But he lost his check because he had, according to the Social Security folks, he had an 18-year-old ticket in Arizona. And they stopped his disability check and said he needed to get that ticket taken care of. So the family members who were illiterate were trying to get a hold of Arizona and go through the bureaucracy to find the ticket, but Arizona was saying there's no traffic ticket. So he's been homeless, living in his van with his dog.
I've been in that van about 6 or 7 years now. It's cold and rough.
But you have no choice.
You got no choice.
You know, every woman that I knew And by no, I mean that I was close to, that I felt like I was like them, had gotten married very young and had babies. You know, middle-class people spend time with middle-class people. So the isolation of poverty, you don't meet people who are doing something different. I never heard the word college. No one I knew had a career. So it wasn't even part of my thoughts. I'm going to be a mom. I'm going to be a mom. I'm going to be a good mom. I'm going to play with them and sing to them, and we'll find a way to get by. That's all I knew. When I was 17, I had a 1 pound, 9 ounce little girl, and she lived only 9 hours. And when she died, I was just devastated because my dream in life was to be a mom. And Wayne didn't know what to say, but he walked to my house, picking flowers from everybody else's yard all the way there, beautiful flowers, and he walked in the door, and he had stolen a little card that said World's Greatest Sister. He didn't have any money, like little at the 7-Eleven counter, and he threw the card and the flowers down on the bed, and I mean, he's always been such a kind, caring human being, but life, you know, I don't condone stealing, but I understand it. My brother Wayne, he's my brother who I'm probably the most like. He spent most of his life in prison. He fights hard to survive. And started as a kid fighting for survival. He was hung when he was 14 by a group of kids. The only reason he didn't die is because my brother Melvin got him down. He got cancer as a kid, survived that. He'll tell the story of watching our dad one too many times come into the room and say to my mom, with a little bit of cash that he had made, should I give all this to the landlord or should I hold a little bit back for groceries? And he'll tell the story of watching Dad go outside and cry and deciding that the people in the big house, just two of them, didn't need all their stuff. And so began his life of crime.
I was too smart for my own good. I saw all these things. I saw the way the world was. I saw Mom doing without food. I saw her not eat so that the kids could eat. For some reason, I was able to perceive that. I just decided that I was going to go take what was needed. And the next thing I knew, I found myself behind bars.
In poverty, life happens to you. You don't get to make life happen. You wait for the next crisis and you react.
Invisible Nation will be 1 hour long when it airs on PBS. They're doing a final fundraising to do one more shoot. They started filming this in 1996. So when you see the full hour, you'll see a whole lot of other things, including a really bad perm from my cousin Wanda. But I can't wait for this to come out. I really believe I've shown it to thousands and thousands of people around our country, and I really believe it's going to help to shift our paradigm to a place where we really are fighting the poverty obstacles that our students and families face and working together with students to succeed in education, because it is the only ticket out. Without an education or skill, your chances of earning a living are what? Slim to none. So 1 minute at your table, what were you thinking as you were previewing Invisible Nation? What were you thinking? And how does it relate to the students you serve? 1 minute. All right, let me ask you to pause your conversation. Now, I'm using that word pause very deliberately because pause means to be continued. And in order to really create systems that are responsive and inclusive, we have to continue these conversations. If it is a one-time conversation while I'm here, it's called drive-by training. So you want to continue these conversations, really examining our practices, our policies, effectively meeting students where they are and setting them up for success. Let's hear from some of you. What stood out to you as you were previewing Invisible Nation? Someone share. Do you have a microphone back there? It usually takes a minute when you push.
For me? Oh, right, there it goes. So that was really powerful, so thank you for sharing. One of the things that Sherry and I were talking about was just kind of this, while I was reflecting on that I read Good to Great by Collins, which is, let me make the bridge here in a second, but it's a really great book on leadership, and one of the things he talks about in the book is this idea of confronting the brutal facts. And I feel like this is one of them, which is like, you know, who are our students really? And I think from you know, thinking of it from a faculty point of view, if you confront those brutal facts, it's difficult because it's going to cause you to have to change how you do things. I think that's scary for people, particularly people who, you know, they've gone and they've gotten a PhD in English, or they love Tolstoy and they want to share that love of Tolstoy, which is not a bad thing. But if you've got a student who, you know, who's in poverty and who's got 20 minutes, you know, a couple times a week that they got to lock themselves in the bathroom or sneak away to the library for 10 minutes, it's like, you're going to have to also care about them and mentor them and coach them, and you can get them to loving Tolstoy, but there's got to be this other stuff too, and you have to address that. You have to confront those brutal facts, and that's the only way that we're really, I think, going to get to a place of a better change.
Well said. And it really isn't an add-on. You know, when you're in a helping profession like education, and you start looking at the best practices for mentoring and navigating the educational system for our students who live in the crisis of poverty, it's not an add-on to our jobs. And I'll show you, it's really, it requires no budget increase, although I will always advocate for more funding to educate our students from poverty. But there are so many things that you can do right now that can impact lives and affect generations.
Yeah, I'll just say one more thing. I know Tony's here from the College of Ed, and they do a lot of work with a community called No Excuse University. And one of their big things is turning around schools who work with students of poverty. And they have this foundation, which I think is also connected with what you're saying, which is that they call it this kind of cultural universal achievement, which is you just believe that every kid can learn. And it sounds simple, but when you really think about it, it's very powerful. It's back to that hope and all that other stuff. So, and I think of the word empathetic instruction. Like you have to have that before you can go to any of these other places.
Yeah, that's number one. And that's strengths perspective. Strengths perspective is believe in the unknown potential of every human you come into contact with. The unknown potential. See, you can't know someone's potential. We're not that powerful. That part of our brain hasn't been developed. We can't predict, but we can sure limit it. If we have low expectations of our students, if we don't build in the supports that they need, we can limit their potential. So if you saw me, age 26, saying ain't every other word, homeless with my two kids and my 15-year-old cousin, massive attitude, big time smart mouth, could you picture me here? I mean, that's where we have to get to. We have to be able to see the student who can't write a complete sentence and go, let's get going. Let's get you going. You know, Dr. Fulford, he took a lot of flack. He had colleagues who would say, you know what? It is not your job to teach a junior in college, not to say ain't. And he would just consistently come back and say, I go to work every day to educate. And that means different things for different students. And for Donna, she needed this piece included. It had to be built in. And then he would say, as I got my bachelor's and my master's and my doctorate, did I achieve my goals? And he would say, and then some. When we invest into building the gaps that our students haven't been exposed to, it's not that they can't know it. It's that they very likely have never been exposed to it in a relevant, meaningful way, which is also critical. But I think you look at so many of our systems and they are so structured
to serve students who have certain kind of context that they're walking in from or they're logging into. Other thoughts on what stood out to you and how does it relate to your work?
What I shared at our table, what has stuck with me from the beginning is that our job is to enable, and how our system, both within education and outside, continues to be fragmented and not supporting those who are in crises. And so it immediately made me think of what are our systems within Ashford that can be improved to better support who our students really are. Anything from what's happening in the classroom to our advisors, are we communicating that right way? Are we following? Are we really sharing our truths and building relationships that are sustainable, that will really give our students what they need to achieve their degree?
And that's really taking a look at the entire system, what I call poverty competency assessment and action planning. I developed a poverty competency assessment and action planning tool to help organizations systemically review their current, like a snapshot of what is it that we're doing right now that is having really great effect for our students who live in the crisis of poverty, really capturing that. And then what are those places where we keep doing what we've always done and we're not having the kind of outcomes that we desire? So I call those areas for growth. So doing a poverty competency assessment requires looking at policy to say, does this policy, or it could even be rules, classroom rules, rules from the instructors, rules from financial aid, rules from whomever they intersect with in your organization. Do these policies and rules really set our students who live in a car up for success? Our students who are coming from the motel, which a lot, we have a motel generation. A lot of people can get up enough to pay for a week's motel, but not first and last in deposits, and right? So they end up spending a couple thousand a month to live in a Roach motel. Or I know a lot of folks now living in RVs and paying $1,700 a month for an RV space so they can have a shower. So are we considering their context when we're thinking about our approaches? So I'm going to give you an example. Going back to that Pennsylvania legislation in the 1700s, I was working with the school district. We were doing the poverty competency assessment. And the teacher came up to me and she said, "Dr. Beegle, can you help me with this 10-year-old boy in my class?" She said, "I have tried everything." And I said, "Well, tell me what you've tried." And she said, "I took away recess. I don't let him have extracurricular activities. He's not allowed any athletics. He is still late every single day, and he will not do his homework." So I said, "What do you call homework when you don't have a home?" And in 26 years of doing this work all around this country, I've asked thousands of school board members, professors, teachers, is homework an effective teaching and learning strategy for people who live in crisis? I've never had anyone say, it works. For many of our students, without a tutor, without a someone to help them navigate these words, the sentence structure, what does this look like when it's done right? I always say, show them what it looks like when it's done right. My instructors, my teachers, they would give us assignments. I would do nothing. It was too big. I didn't understand even how to begin. And then I would see it, the projects from other students or the assignment from other students, and I'd be like, oh, that's what we had to do? I probably could have done that. But I didn't know because it was never and some instructors will say, well, I can't show them what a good one looks like. That would be cheating. And I say, you think middle class families are not showing their students, their kids, what a good one looks like? You think, I taught public speaking for 8 years. You think if my kids have to give a speech, I'm not right in there going, that transition not working. Try again. My son Austin, when he was in fifth grade, he had to do a creative project, and he chose to do the Portland tram. I live in Portland, Oregon now. and he chose the Portland tram. And I came home from working in Pennsylvania, and he said, Mom, come see my room. So I go up to his room. He and his dad had gone to a hardware store. They bought ropes and pulleys. They spent time melting candle wax into the shape of the trams. His room was Tramsville. So I'm watching this kid put this assignment into the box to take to school the next day. Two things I know will happen. One, he's going to get social honor from his peers, meaning that when he walks in with that, the kids are going to go, ooh, ah, he's going to be noticed by peers, which to be noticed is to belong. What's his teacher going to do? Ooh, ah, social honor. He belongs. He's special. I mean, all of those are feelings that all students need to feel. So, and he did. He worked hard on it. But his dad is a senior design engineer. What about the student who doesn't have that? The only learning that's going to happen for so many of our students in crisis, particularly generational and lower working class, is going to happen when they have someone wrapping their arm around their shoulder and saying, let me walk you through this. This is what it looks and feels like. And this is how it comes together. This is how you break it down. It's not doing it for people. It's doing it with. And that's what Maslow said. Don't do it for me. Do it with me. There's a place I got to go, people I got to talk to, assignments I got to do that I don't really understand. Do it with me. And you can mark everything that is right on a student's paper. You still know where they need to work. And so do they. So focusing on the strengths, what's right about people, it's a paradigm shift. It's a paradigm shift that requires us to rethink. Who in here picked up on what my mom was most proud of? Her kids, right? Now, my parents never went to a school conference. What do we say about those parents? What do we say? They don't care. I mean, we are so arrogant, we say they don't love their kids. My mom would say, I ain't going in there to make a fool out of myself. Those people, they want to talk about school. I don't know anything about school. What's the point of me going in there? I could promise you if one person ever said to my mom, hey, tell me about Larry. What's he's interested in? What's Donna interested in? What's Steve, Rick, Wayne, Melvin? What do they like to do? If they get off track, how do you help them? She'd still be there. Pride and joy. Do you know judges use that as a criteria for whether or not children get returned from foster care? Do the parents go to school conferences? You see, all of our systems, justice, health, social service, faith-based organizations, all of our systems are set up by what would middle-class people do? What would middle-class people do? And if you're not doing that, then you're wrong, you're fine, you're right? So there was a guy in Michigan who was homeless, and he caught a fish. He was hungry. But he didn't have a... So they gave him a fine, which he couldn't... So they eventually arrested him, and he went to jail for 14 days. And thinking he was all done with his fine, he gets out, and he's leaving the jail, and they hand him a bill for room and board while he was in jail, because the public voted that people who go to jail should have to pay their own room and board, which he couldn't. So they eventually, he did a year in jail for that fish. Remember Pennsylvania? If we can make it hard enough on him, we can make it tough enough on him. No, quit acting poor. What we should be doing is wrapping our arms around, get in here while we got you. Let's give you everything we can to set you up so you don't have to live in that war zone. And it is a war zone. And I use that metaphor because I have studied the history of poverty in the United States of America. History of poverty, the most common metaphor used to describe poverty is war. Because when humans don't have fundamental needs met, they are in what mode? Survival. Survival. So how do we connect our students and families to the resources and opportunities they need to thrive? That has to be part of our conversation. So I want to talk about a paradigm shift, a deeper understanding of poverty and the students who live in it, a strengths perspective approach, which says, stand in awe. stand in awe. Because if you ever listen to what students go through in just one day in that war zone of poverty, you can't help but go, unbelievable. And you hear it. You should, you, wow. That school I was working with, we found that 10-year-old boy. He was living in the back of a pickup truck with his grandpa. He made it to school every day for 7 months. That's when I started working with the district. And every day when he got there, what happened to him? He was hammered. So they changed their tardy slips to, "We're so glad you're here." No budget increase needed. Get in here. Let's get you going. And they did away with homework. Because they realized only learning can happen, for that kid's going to happen in their building with adults who aren't in crisis, who know that material. So how do we make the learning happen? Not how do our students go out there in this war zone, in this crisis, in this segregation, in this isolation, and figure that out. NASA attitude. When NASA sends people to space, they say failure's not an option. Let's make that our motto. If a student isn't succeeding, let's figure out the why behind that behavior. What are the obstacles in their way? Is it low self-esteem? Has poverty stolen their confidence? Or they don't believe they're good enough or smart enough? How can we set them up to have small successes so they start to believe that they can be a learner? Because it's not failure that fuels motivation. Motivation is the why behind our behavior, and it's driven by small successes. Well, that wasn't so bad. I remember when I got my GED, that was my first one. That was just so bad. Maybe I could get that 2-year degree they've been talking about. And it was also being exposed to people who had 2-year degrees. And I was in a privileged situation where people navigated that for me. Stronger partnerships. What's the strength of your partnerships? The poverty competency assessment looks at policy. It looks at professional development levels of all staff. I teach 11 poverty competencies that you need in order to truly connect, relate in meaningful ways, in order to really look at the curriculum and say, is this relevant to our students who live in crisis? You know, you may know what they need to learn, but there are a lot of ways to get there and a lot of examples that can be used. So how are we building that in? And there's, you know, even differences in adult learning theory talks about involve the learner in the learning. So they can be way more invested in what do you want to learn and how do you want to learn it. You got to write? Well, let's talk about what you want to write about. We know this stuff. When we personalize the learning, our students do better in all subjects when it's personalized. And particularly for our students in poverty, because you've got the pools of poverty that are drawing your attention away. But if it's something I can use, if it's purposeful learning, if it's meaningful, if it's something that I can see what I'm going to be able to do with it, that's going to tie me in and help with some of those pulls of poverty. And if somebody believes in me, which you were right on about that one. So in order to shift a paradigm, we have to take a test. Are you ready? I'd like for you to jot down your answers to these questions. Now, I do want to say that we are a country that believes there's not enough. Who in here has heard there's not enough resources? There's not enough resources to educate students in poverty. There's not enough resources to have affordable housing. There's not enough. That's the mentality taught in the United States. We are a scarcity nation. And I teach that's a lie. So let's take a test. Just jot down your responses to these questions.
Thank you.
Okay, wherever you are is perfect. I'm going to call out the statement, and then I just want you to tell me what you responded. What do you think Americans spent buying Valentines to their pets last February? If you said 815 million, you would be correct. We are an incredibly wealthy country. There's enough. What about the height of our horrible recession? What did Americans spend on Hannah Montana High School Musical and Disney Princess merchandise? $26 billion. I read that, I'm like, is that the B word? In a Great Recession? That same time as we spent that much on Hannah Montana, we spent $33 billion on pet toys and supplies. I have nothing against pets, but when you have communities with better doggy daycare than childcare, I have a problem. We have children, one in five children in this country going hungry. And I know people who will lock up the food if they're late to school. Because we're ignorant about poverty. We graduate people from college without poverty 101, leaving the media as the number one teacher. What about Halloween? Not this Halloween, but last year. What do you think we spent dressing up? $900 million, $500 million dressing our pets. There's no shortage. There's enough land. There's enough food. There's enough in this country. I had a woman in my audience not too long ago. She said, well, Dr. Beegle, do you really think there's enough land for everybody to have a place to live? Look around. There's plenty. We are a land of plenty. But our infant mortality rates for women in the crisis of poverty are equal to Malaysia. Our hunger rates are equal to Romania. We're not a poor country. What about one person to be in a cage? That's the national average. It goes up or down depending on where you live. It's probably a lot higher here, a lot higher in New York, 165,000. What if I gave you, for every student you have that qualifies for a Pell Grant, what if I gave you 34,000? We're spending the money, but what we do as a nation is spend it on the symptoms. So for one kid to be in foster care, the first year, about 65,000. We had a family of seven who were evicted. Mom and dad worked at care centers. Sometimes they got hours, sometimes they didn't. They ended up moving into a storage shed. They built beds into the walls of the storage shed. What child welfare found out, what do you think happened? They took five children away from parents who never neglected them. We have an epidemic of kids being taken away for poverty reasons, not neglect. Because people don't know the difference in child welfare either. We graduate them without Poverty 101. Neglect is mental health. Poverty is, I can't afford a place to live. I can't afford food. I can't afford health care. I can't afford access to treatment. I can't afford... What about Super Bowl weekend last year? What do you think we spent? $14.31 billion one weekend. There's no reason, no reason. I was working in Austin, Texas, and a developer told me for every four houses he builds, he has enough material left over to build one for free. We have enough in this country. There is no shortage at all. So what is the impact of being a poverty-informed education system? Your students feel more welcome. They will get both verbal and nonverbal messages that they're wanted, that people believe in them. They will get an idea about who they can turn to when they need help. They will believe that all of the employees that work at that institution are working together for their success. They will get that feeling. So there's some small things that can make a big difference, but partnering with the community is essential. Building your resource backpack. In the poverty competency assessment, we look at the individual professional development levels. We look at the curriculum. We look at the strength of the community partnerships. So do you know who in your community that can help if you hear students being evicted?
Do you know who in your community that can help if you hear a student doesn't have transportation? There are people. And what I do in when I work with organizations for a long time, we do inventories. Like, who in the community gets paid to fight poverty? Some way their check is tied to addressing poverty issues. Who are they? Where are they? And what exactly do they do? Who in the community cares? Who in the community cares? Who would be willing to get involved and really build supports in so that students have success? And then the third realm is, who in the community is impacted by poverty? Who are they? Where are they? That would be everybody. That would be everybody else. That would be your business community, elected officials. How could they support students and families having the luxury to learn, having access? Do we know who's out there? Do we have full resource backpacks so that it's not you trying to do it alone, but it is a comprehensive, connected approach in the community? I encourage having staff development days where you bring in those community folks and you have them share. Here's what we do. Here's how we do it. Here's how you can get in touch with us. The faith-based community, how could they support? You know, we have, I'm doing some work nationally with the National St. Vincent de Paul Society because they're moving away from helping people to cope with poverty, which is, here's some food, good luck, never mind, you're not literate or you don't have skills or education to earn a living. They're moving toward a model, a systemic change model, that is building relationships and community connections so that they are really truly helping people to move out and stay out of poverty. I just shot a series of 7 training videos with the executive producer of Invisible Nation. So incredibly excited he agreed to produce these training videos, which should be up in a couple weeks on our website. But those training videos come with companion materials, and it's a series of 7 sessions on helping people to gain those poverty competencies. Because with the best of intentions, you often have people who are standing in judgment. And if you're judging, you can't connect. If you can't connect, you can't communicate. If you can't communicate, how on earth will you educate? So getting informed. Like, for example, when I first started speaking 26 years ago, people would come up to me and they'd say, well, you know, the reason they're poor is because they're alcoholics, drug addicts, sex offenders, child abusers, domestic violence. And I'm like, oh my gosh, you've taken every social ill in humanity and put it on people in crisis who have no voice, who don't vote. Who in here has ever heard of a wealthy drug addict? Say it with me. Brittany, Charlie, Paris, Elvis, Michael. Drug addiction is not a poverty issue. There are more drugs in privilege, way more access and more drugs in privilege than there ever is in poverty. The poverty issue is access. So let's say I have the addiction to meth. What's available in your community? If I don't have insurance, if I don't have money to pay for treatment, what's available? What's our nation's number one answer to meth? Jail. It's drugs. So when I train drug and alcohol counselors, I say, hey, jail going to cure meth? I've never had a professional go, yeah, that'll do it. No, what most people tell me is jail won't even cure the addiction of cigarettes, which is equal to heroin. Suppresses appetite, calms your nerves. People go to jail for 7 years, get out, they start smoking again because the addiction was never treated. So some communities, they'll say, Dr. Beegle, meth is destroying our families. And I say, what are you doing about it? They keep asking people in crisis to fix it. They don't have the capacity. They're not experts on addiction. Some communities will say, well, we have a 5-day rehab program. They really want help. The most I've seen is 30 days with a 9-month wait list. So let's say I get in for 30 days of treatment for something big like painkillers or heroin or meth. What do you think is going to happen? After 30 days, I get out. What do you think? I'm going right back. And you don't have to be an expert to know that. You just look at the literature. Because the literature says 1 year intense rehab to be free of meth. And that's not new research. That's research from the 80s. We know what to do. We don't fund it. We don't invest in our people. We pay for the symptoms. So 5 children taken away from their family.
$65,000 a kid, how much is that? Everybody say a lot. If we were a poverty-informed community, what might we have done? By the way, that doesn't even include the cost of the mental trauma of being yanked away from your family. That's going to impact those kids way down the road. So we have enough. Utah has figured this out. Utah has reduced homelessness by 91%. How did they do that? They calculated what does it cost for someone to be on the streets, and it was over $20,000. They went to developers and said, what would it cost to house them? No questions asked. $11,000. Went to their elected officials and said, look, we can save money. And they bought it. So 4 years they're into that program now, 91% reduction. They're on track to be the first state in the United States that has no one who doesn't have a place to lay their head. And it's so cool because they took pictures of the children and the families and the grandmas and grandpas that were on the streets when they were on the streets. And then they photographed them 3 months after having a place to lay their head, a stable house. They're gardening. They look like different people because we humans, we need that. We need that. So being poverty informed requires understanding the facts. What about, has anyone here ever heard of a person in middle class who struggles with the disease of alcoholism? It's not a poverty issue. There's more alcohol in privilege. Actually, I had some judges, they taught me a new word. It was called functional alcoholic. Didn't know that word. The poverty issue is access. If I have that disease, What's open to me if I have no insurance, no money to pay for treatment? Most communities, you get a couple hours of detox if they arrest you. Not going to cure the disease. So we have to have community-wide discussions about what are we doing to invest in our people. Because we're going to pay, right? You're going to pay for the person who goes to prison. You're going to pay for the person, the whole family that's taking. We're going to pay as taxpayers. We're paying. But we don't treat the symptoms and invest in our people, set them up for success. What about sex offense, child abuse, domestic violence? Do those things happen in privileged homes? Of course they do. I mean, we could talk about the Penn State coach. We could talk about the judge who beat his wife up in Washington. We could talk about Bill Cosby. We could talk about, those are not poverty issues. They happen in all social classes all over the world. Poverty issue is access. My newest book is Breaking Poverty Barriers to Equal Justice, and it comes with a 90-minute training video, and I am so proud of this. Because raise your hand if you know we have a justice system that works pretty well for people who have, and a very different one for people who don't. So I partnered with the American Bar Association on this project, and they're distributing this for free to all pro bono attorneys in the country. Because guess who else hasn't had Poverty 101? And what happens is you have so many people, 96% of the people who have civil cases, like landlord-tenant or child support, they're representing themselves, and they can't read a newspaper. So who do you think is going to win? And even if you get appointed, if you're in criminal justice, you get appointed an attorney, what do you think happens there? We have what we call a meet 'em and plead 'em system, where the attorney, legal aid attorney, meets you at the courthouse. There's no pre-work done, no investigative work. Tells you better take the plea or you might get mandatory sentencing, which the American public voted you should have. So we don't have a justice system for people who have. We have ignorance in our system about poverty and how it impacts people. And so you start looking at the facts. Here's some other reasons people stay distant from people in poverty. Like, for example, anybody here ever taken a Christmas basket to a family in poverty? Anybody ever taken a Thanksgiving basket or done a home visit? And you get there and, man, they got a big screen TV. They are watching cable, smoking cigarettes, talking on a cell phone, wearing Nikes, with painted nails and tattoos. Anybody? We don't understand that, do we? Who can tell me the quote? if you're judging, if you can raise your hand and tell me the quote, I'll give you a copy of See Poverty, Be the Difference. Can anyone remember? If you're judging. You cannot connect. If you cannot connect, you cannot communicate. If you cannot communicate, you cannot educate. That's exactly right. So Portland State has a brand new School of Social Work building, and it was named in my honor, and which I really still haven't processed. I went to the ribbon cutting, and this professor said, "Oh, you're Dr. Beegle. I thought you were dead." So that part's weird. But I am thrilled. The donor said, this is going to be the penthouse for people who are going to have their feet working on the ground. And it overlooks the city of Portland. It's beautiful. And they let my cousin Wanda, who's not really good with perms, but she is my graphic designer. So anything on my website, our newsletter, anything you see, that's Wanda's magic. Her mom makes an X for her name. Our moms are sisters. Wanda designed the interior, and she used quotes from See Poverty, Be the Difference. So when you walk in, it says, believe people can make it out of poverty. If you don't, they probably won't. Because our expectations will impact our students. It will limit their potential. It says, if you are judging, you cannot connect. If you cannot connect, you cannot communicate. If you cannot communicate, how on earth will you educate? And it just has quotes all around the whole area. And the donor stipulated that it had to have access for the public to use when it's not being used for classrooms. So I'm told people go there and they're not even there for poverty reasons or to talk about poverty, but they talk about poverty because it's present. Martin Luther King said, if you don't talk about race, you're gonna have racism. Same is true about poverty. If we are serving students who live in the crisis of poverty and we never say the P word, or we don't examine our own attitudes and beliefs about poverty. Like, how many of you have heard people get rich off welfare? It's a common belief. Who's our teacher? Media. Media, number one teacher, media. So 1986, my welfare check for me, Jennifer was 6, Daniel was 2, $408. 1986. And my cousin Linda was living with me. She was homeless. She was 15, but they said, we won't help her because she's not yours. So the subsistence that people get is stretched even farther than we even know. $408. Today, a welfare check for one adult, two children, our national average is $478. How many years is that? 1986 to today. How many of you heard people get rich by having babies on welfare? What's the truth? 23 states in the United States have passed legislation saying that if you have a baby and you're in the crisis of poverty on welfare, we will not give that baby any support. Welfare was originally created in the 30s because we wanted a parent in the home. That was our American value system. We want a parent in the home. Today, the welfare policies have changed so much, like your baby's eyes are open, get to work. Don't have child care. So $408 a month, my rent was $395. Who's good at math? What I have left? $13. So people would say to me, if you save some money and be responsible, we will match it, and you can get out of poverty. You have this great new program. Thank you. Or they'd say, we're not going to give your kids a scholarship to camp because we believe parents need skin in the game. If you don't have skin in the game, you won't value it. Do you know there's no research to substantiate that claim that if you pay for things, you value it? I'll prove it to you. Show of hands in this room. How many of you have ever bought a gym membership and you didn't go? There's no research. This is, we pay for I was up late at night in New York. I'd crossing time zones and that hip hop ab guy came on. I thought, yeah, I'm gonna try that. I ordered the video 9 months ago. Still unopened on my bedside. There's no research, but we use that as a barrier.
to our students and families in poverty.
What does poverty teach? What do we learn from it? This is a photograph of me with my husband, Jerry, my first husband at 15. And would you be surprised if I told you that Jerry came from generational poverty, migrant labor family? Everybody makes X for their names. Jerry dropped out of school seventh grade. I dropped out ninth. I used to wonder, how did I do it? The whole world out there. And I found Jerry. He lives exactly like we do. How did I do that? I know now I could have picked any guy, and he would have been from that context, because that's the only context where I had meaningful contact with people. The isolation of poverty perpetuates it. So I teach that when you're in poverty, you know, nobody said to me at 15, don't get married. No, that was normal. It wasn't until I had middle-class friends, people said, you got married at 15? You were a baby. I remember the first time people said that to me, I was like, baby? You live in the war zone of poverty 15 years. You're far from being a baby. See, our kids who live in the crisis of poverty, they have to grow up real quick because they're right there for the evictions or the hunger. They're right there. They lose their childhoods, just like children in a war zone. They lose their childhoods. If you ask a kid in the crisis of poverty, how much is your electric bill? They will tell you. They'll tell you how much grandma's electric bill is. Ask a privileged kid, how much your electric bill? They get to be kids. And yet so many times you hear people saying, well, they need to learn some responsibility. Really, responsibility is your outcome goal. They got too much. Actually, on the cover of See Poverty, two of the children on there lived in a storage shed for 2 years taking care of their infant sibling. They don't need more responsibility. They've got too much. They need people who understand, who build in supports and connect them to resources and opportunities. So what does poverty teach? I mean, you're sick more. Poverty affects immunity. So students get sick more, and then they don't have access. Our doctor was the emergency room. Get real sick, you go to the emergency room and hope like crazy they give you samples because you can't buy the prescriptions. I mean, we shared everything. We shared antibiotics. My mom was like, here, I had this. I didn't finish it. Take it. Might make you feel better. We shared glasses that weren't even prescribed for the people who were lending them to you. My mom is, she can't see anything up close. Well, I can't see anything far away. So I'm driving with my mom. Not too long ago, I would take her on road trips with me. I'm driving with her and my lens broke and my glasses. So she hands me hers. Mom, she has bifocals and she's like, you don't want me to put those on and drive. And all that becomes very, very normal. This is my first time having a healthy baby. And it was simply because people exactly like you took the time to get to know our family, took the time to find out what was going on and help us to access housing. I'm the first ever in the history of generations of homelessness to access housing. I'm the first ever to use the WIC program. I didn't even know about WIC. Your students may not even know what is possible for them in terms of resources and opportunities. But if you have a full resource backpack, you can share that. Hey, did you know about this? That's what happened for me. And I went to the hospital. I had 6 pregnancies in poverty and 2 lived. But this was the first one I got to leave the hospital with. And he weighed nearly 6 pounds when he was born. I had 1 pound, 9 ounce Joyce. I had 4 pound Jennifer. And he was the first one. And the only difference in my life was I had someone just like you tell me about the WIC program. So I got juice and milk. Nutrition matters for unborn babies. They showed him to me at 6 pounds. I was like, oh no, he's fat. I didn't know. So what does poverty teach? It really does impact the learning in that you become hopeless. In the psychological research, they built these wooden mazes, 3 boxes, big wooden mazes. And you had to get through the maze. The mice had to get through the maze to find their cheese. Yeah, it's like 101. You might remember this case study. In the second box, researchers would shock the mice if they touched a wall. So the mice would come out, touch a wall, trying to get to their cheese. It would zap them, disorient them, knock them down. They would start off again, touch a wall, be zapped, be knocked down. Touch the wall again, be knocked down. Pretty soon these mice, what do you think they learned? Don't touch the walls, right? So they were able to get their cheese. In the third box, the researchers decided, let's shock them no matter what they do. So when the mice started off, the floor zapped them, knocked them down. Disoriented, they got up, touch a wall, zapped, knocked down. Shock from above, the sides. No matter what they did, they were zapped and knocked down. These mice curled into fetal position. And they would die just a very short distance from their cheese. That's generational poverty. That's lower working class poverty. They get the strongest messages that something's wrong with you. The strongest messages. So if you give, imagine that you give a student an assignment who comes from situational poverty, the kind of poverty where they grew up in a more middle class environment. They know middle class vocabulary. They have middle class expectations. They know the meaning of education, that it is your ticket out. See, in middle class world, you get the messages that if you want to succeed, you get educated. In poverty, you get the message, if you want to succeed, you work hard. So when I work with students in poverty, I say, how many of you know people working hard, not making it? So I'm not going to lie to you and tell you to work hard, you'll make it. Two-thirds of the people in poverty are working hard, and they can't pay rent. I saw people work hard my whole life, still get evicted, still go hungry. Didn't matter if they were working. They didn't have skills or education to earn a living, and we have a labor market that demands those things. So I talk to students about how you'd like to earn a living. How'd you like to buy a house for your grandma? How'd you like? Well, there are two ways you're going to do that. Get educated, get skilled. That's it. And usually then they will tell me, I'm not smart enough to do school. I'm not good at it. And what I teach, you didn't learn in school. Someone didn't teach to your learning style. We know there are many different learning styles. We know about multiple intelligence. When I do ongoing work, we get into the learning, teaching and learning and communication strategies because those pieces are essential. If you didn't learn when you were in school, someone didn't use examples that you could relate to. Someone didn't use curriculum that was meaningful and purposeful. People with dyslexia get doctorates. People with autism get doctorates. How do they do that? Someone builds in the supports for that to happen. Someone believes they can. So people in generational and working class are the most likely to lose hope and self-esteem. They're the most likely because they start getting pelted with it from the womb. By the way, their moms are talked to, tone of voice, by the signs on the wall, by the hunger, by the homelessness, the evictions, the experiences that they're having, they start losing hope. And so to rebuild hope, we have to start helping our students see what's right about them. When you help students see what's right about them, makes them feel like maybe I could do this. Maybe it's not so out of my reach. So I got into a pilot program in 1986. It was called Women in Transition. And in that program, they did a lot of the things that I built into our opportunity community model, which we're now in 12 states with. It's a community-wide approach to addressing poverty. But the four women running the program, they stood up and told their life stories. That was the four middle-class women. And there was me sitting there, 26 years old, going, you lived in one house, beginning to realize that, oh, my gosh, they're not better than me. Maybe I wrote in my little brown diary, I'm going to try to get that GED they've been talking about. Then maybe I'll be somebody. I did not. Poverty teaches you you're not. And one of the things they said was, what kinds of things have you done, Donna? I ain't done nothing. I had the attitude. I had the smart mouth. And what I teach is poverty teaches you attitude. If you watched your grandma go hungry, would you have an attitude? Watch your mom do without her medicine, might you get a smart mouth? But the truth is it's not about you. And what happens in helping professionals is we tend, student smarts off, student has attitude, we take it personally. And then we end up in a negative conflict spiral with the very people that we're working to empower. So I was pretty privileged because I walked into a community action agency to get my lights turned back on, and the woman there said, I think we can help you get your lights turned on, but you might want to check out this new program. It's for single moms like you. And she handed me the voucher to get my lights turned on, and then she's telling me about this program, and I said to her, why don't you go do the program?
I had the attitude I had. Now, what happens most of the time in that situation is people will come back and they'll go, I was going to help you, but I'm not going to now. Change your little attitude. Three buses back home, right? Because we take it personally. But if we're centered, like this woman was, and I was privileged to run into somebody who knew that my attitude had nothing to do with her and everything to do with the war zone of poverty. She came right back and she said, why don't you take the number? You never know, it might be helpful. Starting in 3 weeks. I rolled my eyes. I think I even called her an idiot. And I laughed thinking, what am I going to do? Because what she didn't know was not only did I have my lights shut off, but I had a 72-hour notice to move. And I had nowhere to turn. My mom and dad lived in a 10-foot trailer. Two of my brothers and their families already lived there. My dad was invalid. I was about to be on the streets with my kids, which means what? Might lose them. So I drove by Pizza Hut on my way home, and I thought, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? I could go back to work at Pizza Hut. I worked my whole life. We were migrant labor workers. 15, I worked foam rubber factory, where they told me no raises and no promotions for 2 years. But if you stay 2 years, you get both. I stayed 2 years. When I went in for my performance review, I was fired for being too young to be in the factory. You think that happens today? Bet it does. People are working hard, and they're getting knocked down left and right, left and right. So I thought, well, I could go back to work at Pizza Hut, but I just still got evicted when I lived there. When I worked at Pizza Hut, I still got evicted. I still went hungry. My only thing Pizza Hut did was take me away from my kids. And we were all in crisis, and they needed me. But I had that number. And that's why I teach, is if you have a resource and you never know how or when it might come in to be helpful, but get informed about the resources in your community that can change lives. So I called the number and I went to the pilot program, not thinking, oh, this is going to change my life, not thinking any of that. I went because I didn't know what else to do. And I'm sure you have students who sign up right here for that very same reason. I don't know what else to do. And I got there and this woman, she said, you know, we have worked really hard to create a program to help you. Now, one of the things you're going to be doing is Myers-Briggs. And she must have seen at this point that I'm looking at her like, you alien. And she said, she went on and on about, she, oh, Myers-Briggs, that's a program that's going to help you learn about your personality, going to help you know what kind of jobs you might like to get. And I stopped hearing her. I'm thinking, I've got my 72-hour notice is now 48. I'm going to be on the streets, and you want me to do a personality test? What do you think might have happened had she listened first? Might she reframed what she was going to see? That's part of the issue, is we don't always listen. Help me understand what's in your way. Help me understand what's going on. Say a little more. What's the roadblock for you? That's great language to use. So she went on and on, blah, 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 talking, and I was like, oh, I got to get out of here. I got to get out of here. I got to go find some place for my kids. And then she said, and if you complete our 3-week program, you're going to become eligible for Section 8 housing certificate. Can everybody say motivation with me? I was like, I'll do anything you want. I'll say anything you want. You want me to jump a hoop? I'll jump. I'll do anything. Any of my babies have a pillow to lay their head on. And then she said this to me, we're going to help you change what's hanging in the air. Something wrong with me. I'm all my kids have. I have to be okay. And change theory says humans aren't creatures of change. We're creatures of habit. How many of you tried to diet? What happens? You go back to what's comfortable, what's familiar, what you know. Well, if I'm in poverty, the people there, they know me, they like me, they talk like me. But if I step into a middle-class environment like education, what do you think happens? I don't look right, I don't talk right, I don't have the right family, I don't have the right equipment, materials, whatever. No, thank you. Maslow says the human need to belong is right up there with our need to eat. The human need to belong, and that's what that big screen TV is about. That's what those Nikes are about. That's what that That's what all of those material things are about. We're in a society that teaches you're somebody if you have certain things. So if a student walks into school with the right cell phone, ooh, cool, they get noticed. To be noticed is to belong. It's about belonging. And Oprah Winfrey doesn't understand the belonging piece. She doesn't understand poverty. And she lived poverty, but what kind? Often people who've had a lived experience of poverty can be the harshest judges because they project their lived experience onto students who've had a different lived experience. Oprah said she interviewed kids in Africa and asked them what they wanted, and the kids said a uniform to go to school. She interviewed kids in America and said, what do you want? And they said, you could fill in the blank, right? Right phone, right PlayStation, right? And Oprah said, I don't want to help them. Paulo Freire says, every society teaches its people what does it take to belong. In the United States of America, what do we program? You got to have the right genes. You got the right genes. And it's not people in poverty who hold the most debt. Guess who holds the most debt? Can you guess? It's the middle class. The middle class holds it. Because we all buy into the same idea. Got to have the right jewelry. Got to have the right couch. Got to have the right whatever. It's about belonging. You know, and I live in a dump that's condemned or should be. I'm going to go down to that rento and get one of those big screen TVs. It's only $58 a month. Of course, they don't tell you it's for the rest of your life, and you're paying 20 times what it's worth, often at 500% interest rates. You know, the car title loans, payday loans, on average, pawn shops, 500% interest. That used to be called the mob, and it was outlawed, but today, still legal. Gouging people in crisis. People in poverty pay more for everything. They pay more for milk, for butter. New study out, they pay more for toilet paper because they can't buy in bulk. So they're usually in what we call grocery deserts. So they're shopping where? They don't have transportation. So the poverty impacts really do teach you that it's about you. And if I have the right shoes, maybe somebody will notice me. And if you walk into my dump, I got a big TV, what do you look at? Whoa. I belong for just a second. And people say, well, why do they go to the casino? Why do they do lottery? If they don't have education or a skill, they got a better shot there than they do in the labor market. Our labor market demands a skill or an education to earn a living. And you're the ticket. You get to be the ticket. You get to be the one that leaves people in a better place than we find them. And that starts with being poverty informed. I'm going to ask you just with the people closest to you, I want you to have just a 2-minute reflection. What are you learning? What are you learning? And how are you going to use it? What are you learning? How are you going to use it? Just 2 minutes at your table.
Okay, if you can bring your conversations to a pause, and again, pause means to be continued because we want to continue this learning. Learning poverty and gaining poverty competencies, it cannot be a one-time thing. I actually had someone call me not too long ago, and they said, we've already done the race thing, so we thought maybe we'd do poverty now. It doesn't work that way. Both of these barriers, race and poverty, are equal barriers to our students reaching their fullest potential. So we want to be sure that we are really focusing on how do we remove any obstacles that may be within our system, and how do we create those partnerships that can really set our students up for success. Someone share with me, what are you learning? What are you taking away?
I think we're moving in the right direction in really building a dispositional approach with our faculty. I think for too long, in higher ed, we've been so focusing on content and subject matter versus the consumers of content. And, you know, the college that I lead, we've been very purposeful in the type of faculty that we're hiring and developing a heart for students. And we've done a lot of this work with our faculty in the past. And it just affirms that we have to continue to move forward in how we look at those student-facing personnel, whether it's, you know, our admissions teams, you know, student advisors, but especially our faculty.
So gaining those tools for communicating more effectively, I do a whole series of training around oral and print culture communication styles. Oral culture communication is more word-of-mouth communicators, and Walter Ong is a scholar who first linked oral culture to poverty. He found that people living in mostly working class and generational overwhelmingly communicated more word of mouth, and that's a thought process and a learning style and a communication style that is really important to understand. The more dominant style of communicating is print. So if you grow up in an environment where people read for their primary information, you gain the skill sets of print culture. Whereas if you grow up in an environment where people trust people, not paper, if they need to know something to live their life, they go to people. That's going to shape your learning and your communication. So it's everything from being poverty-informed, which is what we've really focused on here today, to understanding the differences in learning styles and communication. So here's a really quick example. When you read, there's a sentence, there's a period, and there's a little space. Sentence, period, space. How does that affect your communication? Like this. You talk, period, pause. I talk, period, pause. You talk, period, pause. It's a very turn-takey style of communication. Verbal communication, oral culture, there are no periods. So everybody talks. And what do we say about students who interrupt? We value judge them, right? They're rude from a middle class print culture style of communication. In the oral culture literature, interrupting is defined as an additive. If I interrupt you, it means I'm adding knowledge to your base for living your life. And all human beings are born oral culture. It's our natural way to communicate and relate and learn. We learned to be more print culture when print came into being, and those who had access to the print gain those skill sets of print culture, and there's several of them in my book, See Poverty, and in videos, online training videos on my website that get into this whole piece. But perfect example, my second husband, Chuck, is a senior design engineer. He grew up in a very print culture environment with literate family members. They're plumbers, but they are owners of the plumbing company, which is a different social class. I tell people he grew up National Geographic, I grew up National Enquirer. We know very different things. I'm constantly having to help him. We all have knowledge, but our knowledge may, just because we don't know academic stuff or middle class sentence structure doesn't mean we can't get that. So Chuck will say to me, Donna,
All five of your brothers are talking to me at once about different subjects. And you're jumping in there. I can't understand what anyone's saying. Because print teaches a very first this, then that linear style of communication. So it's one idea at a time. If an author puts five ideas in a sentence, what happens when you try to read it? You can't. So my mentor, who was a guru in this subject matter, he said, "You're the most oral culture communicator I've ever met." He said, I want to help you gain the skills of print, because that's what's going to help you be successful in education in the workplace. And I want you to retain your skills of orality, because our society has lost a lot of the characteristics of oral culture, which is relationship-based, people-first, which is spontaneity, which is showing your emotions and talking about your feelings. A lot of folks in the middle-class print culture, they struggle to develop relationships. That's why you sometimes can see two people walk by each other and one says hi and the other says nothing. It's a classic oral print exchange. So Chuck will say, they're talking about all these different subjects. You're jumping right in there. I don't know what anybody's saying, because he wants one idea at a time. Beauty of oral culture will tell you what all five ideas are about and what's on TV, who just walked by, what the kid over in the corner is doing, and what song's on in the radio in the bedroom. Because oral culture teaches pay attention to everything going on around you. And what Ong did was he looked at the characteristics of the crisis of poverty, and he found an overlap. So if you're in poverty, do you need people? They come first. You might get those things, but you don't get to keep them. They're going to get taken away. In oral culture, you get your information from people, so you need relationships. So relationships based on identification. So I do a whole series around just the communication styles, the learning styles by social class, so that we have those as a frame of reference. I had a teacher say not too long ago, there's nothing wrong with me, I'm oral culture. I've had people say to me, Dr. Beegle, are we medicating our oral culture kids because the characteristics of oral culture line up almost perfectly with ADHD? And I say, do you need a thesis? Because no one studied that. But it would be a great study for someone. So if you want to know more about the oral culture piece, look into See Poverty, Be the Difference, my book. There's video trainings on my website. There's also, you can get the original source, which is Walter Ong, and it came out in the 80s. His book was Orality and Literacy, which is really talking about how print changed our way of learning, thinking, and communicating. But you have a lot of students coming into our environments who are much more oral culture. And now there's a whole body of literature around secondary orality, which is the use of technology and how that's impacting our communication styles, our learning styles, because it has some of the immediacy of word-of-mouth styles of communicating, but it also has elements of the print. So you can look into that body of literature. Marshall McLuhan was originally the one who started looking into how TV impacts our learning and our ways of getting information. But if you focus around your worldview comes from your community that you spend time in. The people around you teach you how to be in the world. They teach you what does it mean to have a job. What does it mean? You know, the meaning of a job is different to a student from middle class than it is to a student from generational poverty. At 15, I told the teacher, I am so out of here. This stuff has nothing to do with me. And my teacher said, you need to stay in school because one day you're going to want a job. What is the meaning of a job to a teacher? What is the meaning of a job to a migrant labor worker? We're not even communicating. She thinks she's giving me an incentive and a motivator because, you know, teachers aren't overpaid. They're underpaid. I know all of you are underpaid, overworked, underpaid, but probably have a roof over your head, probably have food in your fridge, health and transportation needs met. Might have an opportunity to take a vacation once in a while. So the teacher's like, take this, you should want this, this thing called education. And I'm looking at her from the perspective of somebody from migrant labor, generational poverty. I saw people work hard my whole life, not be treated with respect, not move up, not earn enough money to pay the rent and the utilities. So I looked at the teacher and said, I don't want a job. And how does a middle class person respond to that? We start value judging, right, about what we would, what? You're lazy, not motivated, and you're not going to go anywhere in life with that little attitude. So my teacher said. I went from GED at 26 to doctorate in 10 years. And often I hear people say, students in poverty, they're just not motivated. We have a place in our brain that is our wiring for motivation. We're the same species. What I teach is you're not using the right motivators. The motivators we put out there, the incentives we put out there, are often out of reach or don't make any sense in that context. Like, hey, save some money with your $13 you have left after paying rent, and we'll get you out of poverty by matching it. It's those kinds of things that we do that's unintentional harm, or expectations that we have, or projections that we have about what our students have capacity. We want to be focused on internal capacity, external capacity. Internal capacity are things like, do you have hope? Do you have any confidence as a learner? Do you have a learning challenge? External capacity would be things like, can you afford the books? Can you access the technology? Do you have gas? Or whatever it is that you need to be successful. So listening to the narratives of our students help me understand what's in your way. What can I do to make this a journey that you achieve your goals and reach your dreams? So in my research with students from generational poverty, my doctorate, I focused on students from generational poverty who were able to achieve bachelor's degrees because I couldn't find their voices in the literature. I found articles on generational poverty, but then I would start reading it and it would be about working class poverty, which is different from generational poverty. Or I would start reading it would be about immigrant poverty, which is different from both working class and generational. So there was such a confounding of poverty and race, a confounding of different life experiences of poverty. In my book, I go into many different life experiences of poverty, because if you don't have that foundational understanding, it's difficult to hear your students. It's difficult to listen to their narrative. In Alaska, they say they have 26 words for snow. So they see 26 different kinds of snow. We need to understand many, many different life experiences of poverty so that when students are talking, we're actually hearing them and not projecting what we would do or what that friend of ours that had poverty would do, but actually being able to hear from their perspective what the world looks and feels like and what's in their way and what would be helpful. And listening first is always a great tip. So two variables emerged really quickly in my data of what helped people to be successful. If you go to my website, Communication Across Barriers is my company. The website is combarriers.com. If you go to the website, there are articles on there you can download. One that I highly recommend is Overcoming the Silence of Generational Poverty. That is voices of people from generational poverty who achieve the bachelor's degree, telling people exactly what they need. And I'm so proud of that. It's published in an educator journal. I'm so proud of that article because it's the voices. It's illuminating the voices and perspectives, which are so missing from our work. So the very first variable that came to light that was of help to people was mentoring. It kept coming up over and over again. I got mentoring. And so because of my communication background, I wanted to know, what does mentoring mean? Because meanings are in people, not words. Words are just symbols. What does education mean to you? What does it mean to me? In my doctoral research, I asked that question. Students from generational poverty, number one answer to what's the meaning of education? Stress. Stress of getting there on time, knowing the words, knowing what to do, how it looks, how to finish it, where to ask for help. All of the stress put on my already stressed out family for fees. And so think about meanings are in people. What does a job mean to a teacher? What is a job? Words don't mean anything. We give them meaning from our lived experiences. So the variable that kept coming up was mentoring. So I went back into my research. I wrote a 378-page dissertation, and I really delved into what are they talking about? What is the actual behavior that is happening when they say mentoring made the difference? And I found four things. Number one, someone believed in me. Someone who was educated believed in me. See, that's different than my mom saying, Donna, you really wanted to? You could write them their Harlequin romances. That's really nice, Mom. But what if a teacher said that to me? It is a different message. So it wasn't just having someone believe in you. It was someone who is educated, someone who is using education to earn a living, saying, I believe you can do this, and I'm going to walk with you on this journey. and I will help you get set up for success. So someone believed in me. They were relentless and persistent and consistent, and they didn't give up on me. They believed in me when I didn't believe in myself. And that would be Dr. Fulford for me. Dr. Fulford at the University of Portland died the day I got my doctorate. The day. And I was like, oh my gosh, what didn't he teach me? He found out I'd never eaten out, and he believed that your eating habits are tied to your worldview, and if you have narrow eating habits, I was beans and potatoes kind of a person, if you have narrow worldview, then your world wouldn't be very big. So he made it part of my summer coursework to try ethnic food. My favorite food now is Indian food. He taught me middle-class sentence structure, middle-class vocabulary. He hired me to be a TA when I couldn't write a complete sentence. And I was like, you trust me? He's like, all I want you to do is read through these papers and find the grammatical errors. And I was like, oh my gosh, you trust me? I tried so hard. I learned to write. I also learned that the students I thought were perfect, they made mistakes too. I didn't know that. They all looked like they had everything together. But learning that they made mistakes too, and some of them I could write better than me. I could even write better. So that built my confidence. Plus, he gave me a title. I'd never had a title. I never had anything to say when someone said, what do? Well, a single mom on welfare. Well, people didn't even have to ask me at the campus. I'd be walking down the hallway and be like, TA, TA. I was so, so proud. It gave me a way to belong. Gave me a way to be somebody. I went to Dr. Fulford's service, and there were probably 200 me's there. And everyone said the same thing. He believed in me when I didn't believe in myself. He made me feel like I could do this. He didn't give up on me. He understood that whatever I was doing in that war zone of poverty, I needed to be doing. But he could also show me things I could do differently over here that could get me out. So believing in your students, recognize, people said that people taught them they weren't stupid, that they already knew a lot of things that they could link right into their curriculum and learning. That was the second piece of mentoring. They didn't judge me. That was the third piece. They didn't judge me. They understood that I was doing the best I could with what I'd been exposed to and what I'd experienced. So there wasn't judgment. They helped me get around policies or rules that were stopping me. So my GRE scores, pathetic, pathetic. I scored 36th percentile vocabulary, 6th percentile math. I couldn't get into any college. But Dr. Fulford, he printed out my grades for my bachelor's degree. I had 3.91. He told me before I took the GREs to take 3 graduate courses, because you're allowed 3 graduate courses without being admitted to a program. I had straight A's in those classes. And he laid them on the dean's table. And he said, these standardized test scores do not measure what she can know. They're simply measuring knowledge gaps, the things she hasn't been exposed to. And the dean waived the requirement. Do you know how many people don't have a Dr. Bob Fulford? I'm privileged. Okay, and then they connected me to other people. They connected me to other people who could help me in other areas, be it math or be it housing. So they were introducing them to more people who were using education to earn a living, more people who would mentor and navigate systems for them. And the result of that is you change generations. These are my 2 boys, Austin and Daniel. Daniel's dad dropped out of 7th grade. I dropped out of 9th. And not too long ago, Daniel was doing this. And I said, what are you doing, Dan? He said, Mom, it's probably only about 14 years. I'll have a doctorate. Oh my gosh. I mean, education has a new meaning in my family. 2 of my brothers now have bachelor's degrees, including Wayne, who spent most of his life in a cage. I have so many cousins who have no elementary school, no middle school, no high school, entering grad school. 1 cousin came to live with me at 15. She couldn't read. By 19, she had her associate's degree. And then she got her bachelor's, her master's, and then I got a text. Yikes, I've been accepted into the doctoral program. Potential is unlimited. I see somebody, a senior with 1 credit. I don't go, man, you really messed up. Maybe you can do something with your hands. I say, you get a doctorate, let's get you going. I believe it. And I don't care if they get a doctorate, but do I believe they could with the right supports? Absolutely. Absolutely. Most of my family members, they say things like, Donna did it? We can do that. Because they know I'm not perfect. There's some things I'm good at, some things I'm not good at. And I teach that to students. I took algebra 4 times. I got a D every time. I finally said, does D mean passing? Because I didn't even know that. And this instructor said, yes, but you're going to want to come back and take that course again so that you can get those skill sets. And I said, no, I don't. I never want to see another X again. I'm still waiting for this call. Dr. Beegle, yeah, we'd like to bring you in to do some training, but first, could you let us know what you got in algebra? I tell students, don't strive for a D. Do your very, very best. Ask for help. You have to reteach students how to ask for help because they get taught in poverty. It's supposed to be self-sufficient when nobody is. So the younger guy there that you see, that's my Austin. And that's actually Austin a few years ago. And I'll show you current Austin. That's just my favorite picture. This kid applied and got accepted to college in Hong Kong without telling me, which is where he is now. I mean, these are not conversations we had. I have a niece who wants to be a paleontologist. You can change lives. You can, every single interaction, you can leave people in a better place than you found them. And in a labor market that demands a skill or education, there has never been a time when the leadership of our education institutions has been more important for setting the tone. Poverty's not okay. Poverty's the problem. Our students are phenomenal, and we will work together to build the supports, the resources, and the opportunities for them to succeed. That is exactly what happened for me. Thank you for your leadership.
Thank you, Dr. Beegle. You've given us a lot to think about. And I would invite each of us to think about how we might take this information and knowledge, work it into our work so that we can make a difference in the lives. We can see generations of learners, see education as an opportunity, not something that is beyond them. I would also ask us to look into 2017, getting closer and closer and closer to understanding who our users are, what it's like to see the world through their eyes. So we create learning experiences, policies, procedures, materials, curriculum, instruction that matches them. Would that be cool or what? So let's keep going. Thank you, you guys.